use a solution, use Microsoft Teams to ensure that we are able to communicate, able to continue to be productive. We've actually joked internally that we feel like we're a little more productive in this manner, which is interesting, you know, being able to use Teams. We've been a Teams shop for many years. We're on the Teams beta team, but when you're putting it to real world use in a situation like this, you can kind of see how productive and how powerful it can become. So with that, we're going to cover some specific topics today, the proper setup of Teams, the rollout, configuration. We've been asked by folks to cover things like hardware and phone systems, being able to have really a one-stop shop in Teams, also from a governance perspective in Teams, and then also training and end-user adoption. So with that, not to get too technical as we dive right in, but there's a lot of different pieces of Teams when we're looking at it from a rollout perspective. And there's different users are going to consume it via the web browser, via the application on their machine or on their mobile device, iOS or Android or tablet. And so with that, we want to make sure that we're covering it from a rollout perspective. But also there's kind of understanding of the logical conversational architecture and how does a chat go through and how do you upload files or how does OneDrive and how does SharePoint play in to some of these pieces here. And so what we've wanted to do, what we've done here is really said, let's just dive right in and cover it from these different perspectives. So with that being said, I'm going to bring in Ryan Allen to the call. We can go through and really jump into, again, the core topics of, you know, what does rollout, configuration, governance, training, and user adoption look like. So Ryan, with that being said, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you very much, Aaron, and hello everyone. Thank you for meeting with us today and joining our webinar. To start, I just want to go over everything Microsoft Teams meetings, the simple chats, the simple ways that we can use it to better communicate and better collaborate. I'm sure most of you are working from home. I see that a lot of you were able to join the meeting and in a seamless manner, which means you probably have played around with Teams a little bit, used for some meetings, some chats, maybe even created your own Teams. But looking to get more out of it and rolling it out throughout the entire organization, how is it going to help people working from home? As Aaron said, we've been doing this proactively here at EPC Group, actually a few weeks before we had the stay-at-home order in effect here in Houston, just as showing that it can be done and people can still collaborate, and we even communicate more now that we are working remotely during these kind of crazy times we have going on. I hope everyone out there has been safe and doing well. So I have my screen shared here. I hope everyone can see it just fine. This is just the meeting window that everybody is seeing right now. I'm sure you've used it before. Shows different folks that we have within the meeting. On the right side, I have the people that are listed in the meeting, presenters, and attendees throughout the meeting. You may have saw that when I had somebody join, it let me know that there was somebody in the lobby to accept them, and then I was able to change them to an attendee. Allows me to mute all participants, and if I go that, this will mute everyone in the meeting. If y'all have any questions throughout, feel free. I want to make sure that this is interactive. If you may have a question, I'm sure there's somebody else in the meeting that has the same question, either put it in the chat or pop off mute by clicking this button right here to ask that so we can dive further into it. The great thing about Teams and meeting, whether it's with people in your company, clients, folks in other organizations, is that we can easily have everyone together in the meeting, talking, conversing, we can chat, we can share files. everything that we need as a virtual conference room. And if we want to even share our video, I can click this little ellipsis. I could click the camera here, but it's always great to check if you have the start video with a blur. And what that's going to do is it's going to blur everything around me. Of course, I'm working from home right now. And if you're working from home, you may not want to have whatever's going on in the background. I've been in a lot of meetings with clients where they have kids or family or things going on. As they've had this quick transition to working from home, but it gives you that privacy of whatever's going on around you. Keep in mind, this could be used for if you're at the airport, even after everything goes on and you need to have a meeting, have that personal face-to-face connection. You could be at a coffee shop or on the road traveling, but you still want to have that video, but not necessarily whatever's going on around you and have that more professional setting. Question from Michael real quick. Accepting attendees to the meeting, does this mean you have done manually or you can automate this? So for larger meetings, this can definitely be automated. It's a part of the settings going into the meeting and also an organizational settings from the Teams admin center, which allows you to either always allow people to join the meeting, allow them to show up as someone in the lobby. You can also automate who the presenters are for the meeting. And I can dive into that here in a minute when I go into scheduling meetings. I wanted to have this one to where everyone joined as in the lobby and everybody was automatically presenters, so that hoping that somebody would join in the meeting a few minutes late to where I can admit them and show you how that can work as well. Great question. Thank you. As we go further into just this general meetings, I could turn on the live captions and give it one moment to load through. And while that's loading through, you'll see it here on the bottom here in just a moment. But I want to go into the device settings, because if you're ever having an issue, whether you can't hear or your microphone's not working, you can pull up these device settings, make sure it's set properly on there. And there comes up those live captions for me. Also check your camera and then meeting settings. So this is the only quick meeting setting that you can change within your meeting, which is private viewing. So if I was sharing a PowerPoint file, I can choose whether you can let everybody in the meeting quickly go through the PowerPoint as they'd like and switch from slide to slide, or make it so that since I'm the presenter, only I can change which slides are on there. Just a great thing to note. And then also I can go into these meeting details. So it has the details that you were sent when you were invited to the meeting. I can also have a quick phone number for it to call me, copy over the join info, and then these meeting options right down here. This is actually going to pull up a web page that has who can bypass the lobby and who can present. So there's where I can change it on a meeting level to where everyone can bypass the lobby, people in my organization and trusted organizations, and then people in my organization, and then also choose who I'd like to present. And that option is available when you're scheduling the meeting. Looks like Alexis was asking about the phone meeting service is not standard within Teams. It depends on the account. If you use Cisco and WebEx where it has that built in, you can add the phone number to Teams. Let's see, other than Microsoft provided number or multiple numbers for different countries and be a part of the audio meeting conversation. Great question. So when you're in Cisco and WebEx, y'all are paying for that service extra. If you're in Office 365, Teams is included. That's why it doesn't have that office dial-in number initially. It's an extra license you have to buy, an audio conferencing license, where it's an extra $4 a month for us to be able to have this meeting number right there. And it does give you numbers throughout the world. I can pull up an instance here in a moment showing you some different numbers that we can have, and that's automatically included with your with that license. I'll do that here on the side as I'm going through everything. But yeah, it's great to have that. And then also the enter phone number for it to call you appears. And under the participants, I can start typing in just a phone number and start calling somebody straight from the meeting with that license. And that gives you, per license you have in the organization, it gives you 90 minutes to be able to call that number or to call a number from a meeting. So say if you're just meeting with, if Aaron and I are in a meeting and, hey, we need to call one of our clients on their office phone, well, we're already in this virtual conference, I can just dial it right from there, and that will be, and it'll start ringing their phone. So great to be able to have that capability. I'm not familiar if WebEx has that, but a great additional feature. But enough of the meeting side of it, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask. I want to go into the rest of Teams. So when you're looking to roll this out, hey, we have the great chats. We can create groups for chats. This is a training group I've created. I can have multiple people right here within the chat, add more people to it, include chat history if I'd like. Share files and collaborate. So if I shared any files, they would pop right up here. Add over any tabs of things we might use, maybe a Word document or a Power BI report that I can have for those quick groups. Now, when you hear Teams, all right, so the big part of it is being able to create teams and have everybody work together. When you're transitioning into Teams, we want to take a lot of thought into how are we going to set up the teams, how who's going to be the owner, what's the members, how does that permission and structure really look like, what does that look like, and then what are the different features that's going to get people to really use this? You may have on-prem file shares, or you're using Dropbox or anything else that you maybe before. This lets you really organize it into one team. So this is a team I've created for training right here. And these are channels below. So if I go into managing the team, I can see the owners of the team and members, and I can easily put somebody up to be an owner to where they can help me manage this team, change settings, decide how it's going to function. Great things right there. I've just added a few folks just for training purposes. I can quickly add new people to this team, create little tags to organize people on what they may have. So sales and training, I put Amy under. So if I went to the chat and typed in at sales, everybody with that tag would then be included in this little chat function right there. So it's really keeping all of our conversations together, keeping all of our files together, everything we have right within the same team. Here's the pending request, managing on an owner level, the different channels. Do you want channels to automatically pop up? Everything right there. But a lot of it you really want to take into account is the settings for it. who's going to be the owner of the team? What's the purpose of the team? And what limitations do we want to set? Of course, there's fun things. Hey, add a team picture. Say if this was a projects team, and then all of the different projects that everyone within that team is working on can be listed as channels, so that every file is within there. But you don't maybe want the members to create and update the channels. You want, as the owner, to be able to manage that. And then you don't want them to create private channels, because as the owner, you want to limit who's going to have private channels. So all these great settings you want to go through when setting up that team to take into account. And then if you want to add any guests, so guests are folks outside, say outside of EPC group, I could invite them in to collaborate with me on a team within my company. Choose who has that mentions, and the rest is some fun stuff, team code, gifts and stickers. And then here's those tags as well. So if you wanted everybody to be able to add new tags to members within the group. Of course, we have analytics built in. So as the owner, you can see, hey, how is my team doing within this team? Are they utilizing it? Can we find a way to collaborate better? What more can I add to it? Just really nice to be able to have that option in there and see how it's all working out. You can also manage apps within the team. And then if we go into back to the general tab, these are some chats that just me adding stuff to the team. I wanted to add some tabs up here to show you all the functionality. So of course we have files. We noticed that the file structure here looks a little bit different than my files here. So in Teams, it gives you a lot more, because this creates a SharePoint site for this team, lets you add cloud storage, so connect it to a Dropbox, Box, or Google Drive. Give 1 second. Let's pull this back up. Looks like we have someone joining the meeting. Perfect. Welcome, Nick. And if you all saw how I was able to do that, admit him to the meeting, hover over the ellipsis, and change it to an attendee. Great thing to be able to do on the fly. So we have all our files here that we're all going to collaborate together. Maybe the general tab is general notes for, say, these projects team. And then the tabs, and then we would have files related to just this project under this tab. It's really important to get everything that your teams are going to need within there. And Amy, do you mind accepting that attendee and changing it to an attendee? Next, we always have wikis for every team. It's something that's automatically created. It's a very simplistic version of OneNote, but it's built in automatically. You can remove it from the team if you'd like. The great thing is, though, is that say if you want to incorporate a SharePoint document library that's used elsewhere, hey, you can add that document library in there to connect different teams together or incorporate those file repositories within your team. Fun things like website. So I can have the websites built right into Teams. Say it's one that we collaborate on, or you want the company website to be here. You could even use it as putting in your main SharePoint portal. And as we're on here, I want to go into some of the options and some Teams governance. And Aaron, I didn't know if you wanted to talk a little bit on anything here.
Absolutely. And so within Teams governance, one of the key elements that we try to cover is really the soup to nuts, all parts of Teams governance. And so it can be the rules of the game in Teams governance. It can be anything from the architectural setup, the configuration, also all the way through to how are you training your users, power users, administrators. And so there are many different parts of Teams governance that are key. And so with that, many of you probably use SharePoint. And so you've probably seen over the years how SharePoint's lack of SharePoint governance can turn into like the Wild Wild West and just content sprawl and a mess. And so what we've done is really taken our many years of SharePoint experience and really taken a holistic approach to how do you implement Teams governance. And so within that, we're looking at, we've developed a governance planning guide, questionnaires, what we'll send out to our clients to say, okay, well, how are you currently collaborating? How are you currently communicating of information, discussing, sharing documents? And then from there, we'll go in and actually create the governance strategy based upon that. So a lot of different pieces, a lot of different ways that we can go in, but it really is the full spectrum of Teams. What does it look like as far as organizational structure and channels? What does it look like to go through? Who can add a channel? Who can invite? What does it look like in private channels? How do you share content from internal or external users? What does it look like of managing a team, going through the roles and responsibilities of that? And so that might tie to different groups. How do Office 365 groups play into that? How do the key features play into those pieces as well? Thinking things like bots or other integration elements. We have a very powerful piece where we have shifts and we're able to track shifts of when folks are checking in or starting their day or checking out or ending their day, especially in the remote working environment where we're at. It can actually track location. It can track all sorts of IP address. I mean, depending on how deep you want to get there in that. But we can basically cover in this remote working world, that we're finding ourselves in, we can not just use Teams for, document sharing, but there's all sorts of other features and communication and chats and phone calling, but there's other key features that we can utilize. And going back to governance, there are team level settings. There are things that we want to allow folks to be able to do or not to do. And so from a governance perspective, it's really holistic. It's really kind of anything and everything in Teams should fall into governance. That's saying a lot. But if you kind of use that SharePoint mindset of we don't want this to have content sprawl, we don't want this to turn into the Wild Wild West. Many have seen that. I think it helps give a mindset of where we're coming into governance. But go ahead, Ryan.
Thank you very much, Aaron. And touching on those few things, especially shifts, I find that's a very interesting one on here. I have a few questions in the chat that I want to address. We have one, is there any way to turn on a notice like you see a chat bubble so that you know there is a new message in the Teams icon? So there's the chats right over here. These little chat bubbles are going to pop up for whenever I'm getting chats. These are going to be in my recent chats. I get the notifications on calls. And then I also get a little notification at the bottom of my Teams channel. For notifications, you can actually change those right up here into your settings and change how you receive those notifications. A banner is going to pop up a little window letting you know that you have a new message or you're mentioned or something new is going on. The email portion of it, you decide on missed activity emails. So if I don't get a message from somebody, I can decide how often is it going to shoot me over an email, let me know, hey, there's something going on in Teams that you were mentioned in or a chat you were a part of, just to bring it back to your attention. Next question was, can chat history be deleted? Definitely. I can go over more options and delete a chat that I send. And then on an organizational level, you can set automatic retention policies for all of your teams. The automatic retention policies are decided are as little, I believe, as 7 days, but they're trying to get it to 24 hours right now. It's in the works, not quite there yet, but at least it's at that 7 day mark where messages are automatically deleted. Good question. And Shepard, I know, or Douglas, I know you have a question on Teams for nonprofit licensing. Microsoft does have discounts for charity, and we get a discount for that as well. There is 6 months free of E1 licensing out there at Microsoft.com for people that just need to use Teams and need to have that. I am also posting in the chat a quick snippet of our Microsoft licensing for charity folks as well. 1 second, I'll post that right in there for you. All right. Going back to the Teams, I just want to show you how more you can bring user adoption in Teams, but also make it easier for everybody to have everything they need in one manner. You can add these apps to your Teams, whether it be within a team or on the side that I've done up here. But say you don't see the app, but you have maybe a website you typically go to often or your employees use. That's where this great website functionality comes in. But maybe you want to create a plan for the team. You want to be able to assign tasks, add notes to those tasks, attachments, assign it to a person within the team. All those are great by incorporating Planner within your teams. Create different buckets. Go through and see a chart. See how well we're doing on our tasks. How can we keep it all more organized? And then also see the schedule right in there from all those tasks we have assigned within the team. Keeping people on task in Teams, collaborating, chatting, whether they're at home or in a month or so when we're back in the offices, if and when. But having all that on there is great so that you know folks are still working hard, they're able to collaborate. It actually saves so much time. In a minute, I'll have Aaron touch on some case studies that we've done on how much time it actually gives back to employees that have teams set up properly within an organization. But first, I want to go over, this is OneNote. If you've used OneNote before, great to have it on here. Microsoft does have, they've disabled it to read only in Teams for the coming weeks. They're doing some repairs on the back end. But then I can throw in Power BI reports right on here, be able to see them in real time, switch between dashboards, have all that pulled right in. All of your recordings are held in stream. You can create a channel for your stream, keep all those recordings in one manner, in one page for maybe client meetings that you've had. Great to keep those recordings and have everything in the same spot so that you can easily access it if you need to go back for some notes or whatever it may be. Great to have that on here. You can incorporate Flow to send off, well, it's now Power Automate, but send off custom workflows that you would like. There's hundreds of templates already, or we can create custom templates, custom workflows. This one down here is post a message to Teams when a new task is created in Planner. Great. We can incorporate Power Apps. So really bringing in the whole Power Platform within Teams. These are custom apps that can be created. Show you just some of the different ones that we have on here to kind of get your brain going on all of the different options that we have. site inspection, being able to put that on there in real time, being able to add GPS location, add photos, use the camera, Estimator Pro, just really, really powerful stuff here. One that I see folks use a lot, which is, let me find it real quick, Meeting Capture. So say you're having a meeting with the client and you're using Office 365. So it brings everything right in here to a meeting capture. We'll see it's showing different meetings that I've had go out throughout the day. So let's see. Here's this meeting. Start this meeting. It's going to automatically show the list of attendees. Start taking notes. As we're in the meeting in real time, I can take notes, assign these tasks to folks within the meeting. Set a due date. So we're already organizing and collaborating in real time within the meeting. We're adding attachments, everything we went over. We can have some sketches done, use the camera, everything on there, and then finish and stays. I can choose it to send an email out to everybody within the meeting, which I won't send an email out to all of y'all, just with this. I can have it connect to, export it to OneNote, export it to your office planner, and then it's going to send in real time all of these notes, everything, the whole capture from the meeting. Great to keep everything organized and really use Teams to its full potential and full extent to keep everybody on the same page, everything in the same meeting. Any questions on any of the Teams, how we can utilize it? I know I threw in some Power Apps and Power BI in there, just really showing you all the full capability and spectrum of it. Okay, as we go down, we saw the Teams, we saw the settings, we saw talking about governance and different functionalities we can add in there. I wanted to also note, like, say, there is, if you have like ADP, your folks at your company use ADP for payroll or things like that, you have all of these that can be thrown in there. Adobe Sign, so you can have like the DocuSign version, sign documents in real time on here. Your calendar is linked to everything you're doing within Outlook, all on the same page, scheduling meetings very quick. Using the scheduling assistant to find a good time that we can both meet. Okay, well, we have some time here at 1 p.m. Perfect, we can set up a meeting. We see a lot of folks are transitioning all of their work phones from desk phones into the cloud. They're putting it in Teams. That way, when they're not at the office, say in this disaster recovery plan, they can still get all their work phone, their work calls. Everything is in Teams. This is my work number right here. I make my calls right out of Teams. At work, I have a Teams desk phone, but I don't have to always use that phone. I can use the app on my cell phone, on my personal cell phone. I can use the desktop app. I can use a headset, all sorts of things. I get voicemails right in here. This one looks like it was a spam voicemail. But I get all those calls right in there. It's nice to have it kept nice and simple, everything in one place. I have my shifts incorporated in one place, my calls, all of my files, all of my meetings. I can add more and more stuff in there. Really powerful to be, when set up properly and you envision all the things that you're folks in your organization use on a day-to-day basis, how can we bring all that in right here in Teams, collaborate, be able to work remotely, and do it efficiently and stay on task. With that, I'll pass over back over to Aaron to see if he had anything to discuss and kind of leave the floor also open to any questions or answers. I didn't want to dive too deep in, just wanted to touch on those notes to if y'all had any other information we'd like to dive more into, welcome to.
Yeah, sounds good. And you know, one of the points that were brought up was brought up earlier is, well, what is the real ROI of Teams in that? And so what we're seeing as far as Teams and the rollout, we've done quite a few ROI studies with our clients, and we're seeing about 3 hours per month of additional time that we're giving back to users. And so if you have 200 team members in your organization, and we're giving back 3 hours a month because they're not hunting and pecking, they're not searching around, they're not sifting through emails to look at if they're CC'd or BCC'd or just all the different kind of manual things that you do, that's literally 600 hours of additional productivity or additional time that you're giving back to your organization. And let's say the average team member is, you know, after insurance and 401k and all in, you're looking at maybe $30 an hour. So that's $18,000. So it's 200 folks, 3 hours a month, 600 hours after you take, you know, the hourly rate of what they cost, you're looking at about $18,000 of real actual, this is what Teams is saving us as an organization of 200 folks. And you know, that's over 12 months, that's $216,000. And so you can actually put some real dollar figures to say, okay, well, if your CFO or you know, IT director or whoever it might be is saying, well, what are we going to benefit from this? What is it going to actually do for us? So, you know, a standard organization of 200 folks is going to save around $200,000 a year of just additional productivity. And if, you know, it may not be, if people have 3 hours back a month, maybe they're not going to use all of that time for productivity, but it's, if it's half that, you know, if they're using an hour and a half a month, you're still looking at $108,000 of true actual savings. So the project is going to pay for itself very quickly and, you know, within months. And so with that, we also have some had some additional questions that that were emailed in as well. But, you know, just looking at that and also before I dove into some other questions, I wanted to see if anyone else had any in the chat. And if not, I'd be happy to start to read in the email questions that were sent in as well.
Yeah, Aaron, let me touch on some chats that came in real quick. Sure. So we have Alexis was asking if there's a way to customize the dashboard when participating on Teams meetings, for example, focus on 2 to 3 people. In addition to the one speaking, split screen between meeting and calendar, for example, instead of small. So if I want to focus on certain folks in the meeting, all I got to do is hover over the ellipsis, click pin, and then that person's going to be focused right there on the front of the meeting. If I want to pin a couple people, I can do that. And have those right on there for you. Now, the question about collaborating in the same calendar and having that calendar right on there, unfortunately, not an option yet. I think it's supposed to be rolling out this month, I'm crossing my fingers, on a way that you can right-click on chats, and you would actually be able to pop it out and have multiple windows of Teams. It's supposed to be done this month. Hopefully Microsoft finishes that up. Next, Mark was asking about working from external users. Typically a learning curve you struggled a little bit with. What do outsiders need in terms of software and video? We run into this issue in just about all meeting softwares, whether it's Teams, WebEx, Zoom. Teams is on the newer ones, so maybe some folks haven't used it as often. They've used Skype for Business, maybe. It's great if you add in the call-in feature for them to have it. Other than that, if you send a meeting to somebody external, they don't have Teams, they don't have Office 365, maybe they're on G Suite, they can still join the link in the meeting that is emailed to them. They don't have to sign in or anything. It'll only just ask them for their name to log in. It's an anonymous user, as long as your organization allows that. Really nice and easy as far as anything they may need, headset or audio on their desktop or the call-in feature. I see a lot of folks that don't have headsets, don't have the call-in feature, but they have the app on their phone. That works too. Michael asks, given you use this with your staff, internal and external, can you implement company branding to the Teams console? Unfortunately, not yet. I will show you for external. It's going to show right up here, but if I invite somebody to it, this is one of my clients that just invited me to their Teams team to collaborate on there. So it would automatically show up in the top right-hand corner. And then when scheduling a meeting, let me show you this. This part right here is fully customizable for every meeting you have. That is where you can throw some company branding on there. And that would be a standard. So standard, everyone, we go out, we have our logo within the meeting. And Aaron, did you have, I think you had some questions.
Sure, yeah, and I know we have a few minutes remaining here on the webinar, but I think one of the key pieces here is, you know, in Microsoft's roadmap, Teams is becoming the hub for everything. And so as far as the roadmap, I know that just as a history from EPC Group, we started it off doing, back in the day, it was Office Communicator, and then Link, and then Skype for Business, and then Teams. And so Teams is the final version that Microsoft is releasing. It is in their 10-year roadmap as far as it being a platform that is going to stand the test of time. We do see a lot of these where if I go to epcgroup.net and just take a look at in our site, we have our Teams consulting, our Teams governance, our phone system offerings. And so with that, again, we really try to talk to our clients about, well, even if you're not going to do Teams voice right now, it's important to think through what that might look like. What's the foundation? You know, the water lines, the gas lines, the electrical. Should you want to add phones, or should you want to, you know, wire up your conference rooms with Teams devices? Or, for example, our video conference, our large conference rooms, we have the full-blown video, and so we have the A-Link devices, so we can really do the full, video capabilities. We have offices, you know, throughout the United States. And so with that, trying to be really that one-stop shop, but at the same time, as Ryan mentioned, we're going to have the Power Automate, which was, Flow, recently renamed to Power Automate, where you're going to have workflows. You're going to have different aspects of tying this all together. Teams is the glue for really anything and everything in the Microsoft stack. You're then going to have maybe some Power Apps where you have basically some applications that you're going to. We do a ton of Power Apps development of Power Apps applications, but we tie those through, and Teams is the hub for a lot of our Power Apps solutions. You can then go through and, do Power BI and embed Power BI inside of Teams. And so you have your full-blown Power BI reports and dashboards. And then, of course, Dynamics 365 is also inside of Teams. And so as this all ties together, Teams is the glue for this. And I think you know, the last piece of on the agenda item was training and robust end user adoption. And we can't stress enough how important it is to roll out teams in a manner that you're going to make sure it scales, you know, whether you're teaching folks how to use the telephony pieces of Teams or you're going through and training your power users in Teams. There are some specific core items that everyone should understand to get the most out of Teams. And so within that, it's just, again, it's important to, you know, and again, in the situation that we're all finding ourselves in the remote working, how do we get the most bang for the buck out of Teams? How do you quickly stand it up so that it's governed, so that it's controlled, so that you have the best practices strategy and best practices? That's the words thrown around a lot, but you know, keep it simple, but make sure that it's done right and you're taking advantage of all the features. And so that's really what we wanted to stress, you know, in today's webinar is, you know, what are the roles and responsibilities? You know, what does that look like? You have a few power users that are going to kind of do the care and feeding. What does your organizational structure look like when you're creating your teams and your channels? Is it project-based? Is it more departmental-based? Making sure the right permissions and security are tied into those. You know, what are the processes? Simple things like, what are the processes for creating and managing teams? Or what features do you want to enable or disable? So we want to really, you know, keep it simple. We covered a lot of the features today, but, you know, if anyone has any questions after this webinar, actually, if you go out to EPC Group and you click on one of our sites, like my Teams consulting site, you're going to see this pop-up window here load in a matter of seconds. I've kind of disabled it here on my screen to not load so fast. But as it pops up, these are actual team members here at EPC Group. And so if you have questions, you can actually ask it. And these are live EPC Group employees that have experience in Teams. So feel free to ask us a question. You know, you can give us a call, shoot us an email. We try to be real responsive. We're working through the weekends. We're working late at nights. We've actually shifted some of our other implementations around some of our other services and focused to help support clients. We have many clients that are need to be in Teams yesterday and are, again, are experiencing some panic as far as having old school VPN connections or having some old school architectural you know, just pieces in place and need to get into Teams. So, you know, we try to be understanding about your timelines and what you may want to accomplish. But with that being said, we pretty much are wrapped up for today in this webinar. Give everyone back about 7 minutes of their day. But, you know, really appreciate everyone joining today. Please stay healthy and safe. Should you need anything at all, please reach out. And with that, we can pretty much wrap it up. So thank you all for your time. If you have any more questions, again, just shoot us a note and we'll be real responsive. So everyone stay safe and have a good rest of your day. Thanks for your time.